on approaches and stuff. We have wind shear in this valley that you cannot imagine. You would not want to see it, what goes on as far as wind shear. You want to set up a good approach. You want it to be stabilized. You want to be on your down tubes. You want to do everything exactly the way you were taught, the way you know it needs to be done. If you're turning close, low to the ground, again, you're dancing with the devil. MacCready, the guy that invented the MacCready wing, the guy that sent the Gossamer Condor across the English Channel, smart guy, right? MacCready is a smart guy, hang glider guy. He says that winds in excess of 15 can exceed the roll capability of a weight shift glider. Winds in excess of 15 are commonplace here in the valleys in the afternoon. Set yourself up a stabilized approach. If you're showboating and you're doing stuff close to the ground, you're gonna get hurt, you're gonna break shit, you might get killed after. We lost Lou Heinonen over years ago over at Treasure Valley, and he got turned downwind on a topless, and hit going downwind in a topless, and it popped Lou's bag of water. I was there with the corner. Lou had as much experience as all of us combined. Okay. So please, be stable, be conservative, treat this place with respect. In the evening, there's all these canyons darken up in the evening, and cold channels of air run down out of these canyons, and they form a river of cold air that perhaps undercarves that warm air and creates that incredible glass off. But Alan Peddler will tell you, if you're on a paraglider or hang glider, you don't land close to the base of these hills in the evening because of wind shear. You come out to the valley, okay? So, and I've experienced it in the tow plane, deep dark holes at 100 feet. It'll make you cry, mom. Okay, so be conservative, be smart, be safe out there. That was my serious point that I wanted. Okay. Can I get out the clown box?
Please.
You know, where's Chapman? Chapman?
Where is Chapman?
No. There's supposed to be an airline pilot here for adult supervision. He'd like to grab it.
Looks like Tola.
Ah, you're going to do your
long.
This, in the airline pilot world, if you want some funny stuff, you go into the break room and you ask, how does an airplane fly? And my God, you'll never fly on an airliner again.
There's no answers.
Jeez, whiz. So, the clown box. Has some bubbly shit, and then it has a little baby thermal, and then there's some more bubbly shit, and then here's a bigger thermal. Anybody ever fly with Paris Williams?
Yeah.
Anybody ever here read the book Secrets of Champions?
Yeah.
If you haven't read the book of Secrets of Champions, you are missing out. There's about 7 chapters there that aren't worth a shit, and there's about 5 chapters in that book that are absolute solid gold. And Paris, I believe, is one of them. The Zen. So, what we have here is, looks like 3 thermals. A little thermal, a big mother, another little thermal. And then, connecting these thermals is some lift lines. We're trying to make these lift lines. Notice that none of these thermals are symmetrical. I saw people yesterday, it's hard to work on a tractor when you guys are up there skying out. We're trying to. I saw people trying to fly symmetrical circles and real shallow bank angles, and they were going down. At King, when the pressure like today is about 30-10, if you get below the tree line and you find a core, you better have a steep bank angle, at least 45 degrees. You ain't going to stay in that bad boy. You're going to fall out. So, this is what Parrott taught us. He said that there's lift lines that connect the thermals, and the hawks know this stuff. You watch the hawk, he comes through a line of sync, blue sky area. He finds the bubbly air. He'll turn either upwind or downwind. Today I'm running downwind. Okay, so he's coming along like this, and it's real smooth. Here's the sink line. It's high pressure air, it's sinking. It's glass. And then it starts getting bubbly. The texture changes. And the hawk will either turn upwind or downwind. And that bubbly stuff. Okay, now here's the key part. This is the Paris Williams stuff. A wing gets lifted. You wander over towards that lifted wing about 20-30 degrees. It takes you to the lift line, will take you to the thermal. Now I'm going to make a bigger thermal here, because this is where it gets weird. This, we're going to depart from Paris, and we're going to go to the Kangases and can I borrow a bottle of pop? Don't drink this bottle of pop for at least 12 hours. This is a big pond of water, right? What happens when we drop a rock into a pond of water? Boom, waves radiate out. Well, this thermal is doing exactly the same thing. I've taken pictures out at the Hanford atomic sites where the thermal plumes are coming out of a stratus layer, low fog laying over central Washington. And that thermal plume generates these bow waves that radiate out away from that disturbance in the force. Okay? So now let's say we're on our glide and we got the single arm going. Here we go. We're just gliding, it's smooth, and all of a sudden we get a little beep, 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 beep. This wing gets lifted. That's the first bow wave. It's the weakest. It's like surfers. It's a set of three. I generally find three bow waves around these big thermals. So we make that little turn towards that lifted wing. And here comes the second bow wave. Beep, 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 beep. Now you amateurs are going to try to thermal in that. You ain't going to succeed. That wasn't it. Wait for it, wait for it. Here it comes. Beep, 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 beep. It peaks, and then as it starts to drop off, beep, 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 that's where you make your turn. Which way do you turn? I actually let it pitch me away. Beep, 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 beep. Boom! I'm on. 45 degree bank minimum. And often you can find the core in the first turn. Boop, 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 boop. Up you go. Lift lines connect those thermals. Here's another one for you. You're up at King, there's some big ridges that radiate off the peak of King. Paris taught us this one too. Over those long ridges, coming down to the knob, you can see them running down the range to other points and knobs. The air doesn't dip under those ridges, the air rises up over those ridges. The air rises up over the air rising up over the ridges. It bellies up over the top of itself. And those lift lines will go clear out to the valley floor from the peak. You just got to find them. Sometimes they're right over the ridge. Sometimes they just radiate out. They fan out. Lines of sink and lines of lift. If you can find those lift lines, you can work them. Fly towards the lifted wing. Beep, 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 beep. Fly towards the lifted wing. Beep, 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 beep. And you can walk that lift line out away from the ridge and find the big kahuna. Beep, 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 beep. And far enough from the ridge, you can actually make it work. When you're all down in real close, tight to the terrain, and scratching, 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 the thermal hasn't formed. It hasn't released. I saw some people trying to work the thermal generators yesterday. Time you got there, you were way too low. You need to get over those thermal generators 200, 300, 400 feet. It's where something's kicking off and it's working. You get down there at 50 feet, 60 feet, 100 feet above the thermal generators, you're going to the LZ. I'm laying bets down there.
Is that like just fucking organized? Like kind of organized?
It takes a while. It's got swing. It's just drawn. It's grabbing. It hasn't formed. It hasn't really started upward movement. It's hanging on. It's got cling, you know? Yeah, you got to. That's why often the middle range, like the knob and all the middle range knobs, are so good further out, because by the time the thermal's cooked off and you've hit it at altitude, that thing's going up, and it's been going up at, you know, 1,000 foot a minute for 3,000, 4,000 feet. Incredible energy. Further out is often much better than in close. So there you have it. The radiant, the waves, I call it the disturbance in the force, or like in the book Dune, worm sign. Those waves radiate around that disturbance, that big thermal. And if you're flying along and you get big sink, beep, that can only mean one thing. Somewhere the big kahuna's around you. And again, if you're in sink and you got a wing dropping, turn towards the lifted one. That'll take you away from the sink. Take you towards wherever the...
That's how big these lift lines between turtles?
You know, it could be bellying up. You know, when we see the cloud streets that form, they form parallel to the wind out over the flats. Cloud streets form parallel to the wind. You know, in the macro, when you have a big low pressure system and you have fronts and pressure waves sweeping around that low, you've got lifted bodies and you've got sinking bodies, and lifted bodies and sinking bodies. And there's undulations, there's movement in the atmosphere. It's on the micro, it's on the medium, and it's on the macro. That's all a front is a big wave, right? Sometimes you'll get waves out in front of the main front, you know. They say that theoretically overall the atmosphere is like what? One part's going up and five parts is coming down. So if your one part's going up at 1,000 foot a minute, the other four parts are coming down at about 200 foot a minute. There has to be equilibrium. So if we've got thermals and in between those thermals are buoyant lift lines, there has to be makeup somewhere. So over here is some sinking air mass. And then adjoining it further out is some lifted air mass.
And then there's the vorticity.
These generally form parallel to the wind flow, but when you get high terrain, these can form on the back side of the ridges. Should I go into the wave effect?
Absolutely.
Okay. We're going to leave this drawn in here like this. Now the wind isn't blowing this way. The wind is coming from this direction. And this is King Mountain or Sunset Ridge, and you're jumping over the back side of King. Often, when the mountain meets the valley floor, you'll encounter what you think is a thermal on the jump heading over for Satellite on Route 3. And you'll try to circle that. And the winds aloft on this day are pretty strong. They're up 20, 30 knots. We're starting to get some mountain wave effects. And so what'll happen is we'll be on glide sink. We're in the backside of King. Ooh, we're coming out of 16,000. We're moving for 15,000. Then we hit this lift. Beep, 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 beep. And so we try to thermal in it. And we lost it. It was not a thermal. It was a rotor that lives underneath that mountain wave. That mountain wave is doing this right here, right about where the mountain reaches the valley floor. Mountain wave's arcing up. We got high velocity up here, lower velocity down here. Here's your rotor right here. Can you see it? Here's your lift body right here. So we're going to bias this. This isn't a symmetrical thing. It's a non-symmetrical thing, this lifted portion of this rotor. And when you hit it, what you got to do is think of it in terms of holding a fixed position over the ground. You can do a serpentine back and forth like this, like you're doing a little ridge lift, and you'll go up like a rocket. But to hold your fixed position right over the ground. That cloud ain't going to move. If you see those clouds forming on windy days, they form on the backside of Sunset and the backside of King. They'll form right here above this town. There's a cumulus cloud right there. The winds are blowing 30 knots, and the cloud ain't moving. You'll see this at Reno all the time, Slide Mountain, when the wind's blowing. There's a cumulus cloud over the valley, and it's not drifting. That's a rotor. Okay? Another thing you can do, too, is you can just run real heavy bias, like extend well to windward. Do a quick, tight button hook, flatten out, extend well to windward, and you can hold that fixed position above the ground. Backside of a jump-off, I've gone to 18,000 feet in rotor. And once I learned that trick, then the whole game of King became a different game. Because it was always before, in my mind, the windward side was freedom and success, and the leeward side was death and disaster, groundage, or the famous Gravich. We got to bring up Gravich again. Where's Gravich? Gravich! Gravich, we missed you, buddy.
Hey, don't be stealing my thunder.
I'm taking my clothes off, woman.
Don't be stealing my thunder.
I'm taking my clothes off.
More.
Here's Gravich, grounded, looking at all the gliders go over his head. Right? Year after year after year, but you notice he drew the clouds parallel to the wind and not perpendicular. And on this windy day, they're actually lying parallel to the mountain range. Those cumulus clouds are on the back side of that ridge, about where the mountain meets the valley floor. There'll be little pops of cumulus. There's a lift line that connects them, and I've ran that lift line all the way up the back side. Then it's a short jump over to the ridge, get over on the back side, and work the lee side. Remember, we talked about this last year. We had guys that came out and used it, and they went further than they'd ever gone. They came back and they said, that is some amazing stuff. Lee side, mountain wave lee side, rotor stuff. And then Bobby Gladix, that's flown sailplanes around here a lot, flown them in New Zealand and whatnot, he says, yeah, there's rotor here too, John, but it's also a breeding ground for thermals. It's a real high propagation area for thermals. It's protected from the wind by the mountain. There's draw and pull. That buoyancy exists, so it's a breeding ground for thermals also in that same zone, down low. But when you're coming off a King and you're at or near mountaintop height or a little above, it's probably rotor. Hold a fixed position directly above the ground. If your GPS says you're not moving and that vario is going off, stay right there. You're going to go right up. Kung Pao.
One other question. What kind of varial were you emulating there?
The only kind I ever flew with.
One that goes, can I record your voice? I like it a lot better than my 6030.
Absolutely.
Did you like to sing on? Ooh. It was just a Broniger Sonic glued to the back of my helmet. That's all I ever liked. Huh?
I want to record your voice and transcribe
it on the mic. But anyway, look for those bow waves. You're going to like it. You're going to like the way it makes you feel.
What causes the bow waves again?
It's the disturbance in the force. It's the, there's this.
The thermal itself.
This giant mass, billions of pounds of air is rocketing upward at high velocity. And it's a disturbance in the force. And it sends these waves, these disturbance waves, just like dropping a rock in a pond, sends out these disturbance waves. And many times I've found those right before, and it makes me so happy. I did a video years ago just short of saddle, where I went, beep, 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 beep. And in the video I go, all right, it's out here. Beep, 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 beep. There's the second wave. Beep, 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 beep. There's the third wave. And then, boom, here come the big
one. No, because I have to a lot of times do patience, okay, now. Yeah, I can understand.
Count them. You won't be surprised to find sets of three.
Yeah,
first one light, next one bigger, the one just outside the thermals, the biggest wave, the biggest pressure wave. Has anybody ever read that, seen that, or heard that anywhere in the body of knowledge?
No. Never, but we've experienced it all. Yeah.
There's your Kangasism for the morning.
Yeah.
And the clown box.
Well done.
Here.
I thought it was going to explode like a clown box.
You're thirsty, aren't you?
I am now.